errors and mistakes happen. Should you practice indulgence with people, or should you be rather straightforward when you deal with their errors? And this is exactly our topic. We are asking ourselves, we're going to discuss how to find the right amount of indulgence to practice and how to find the right amount of showing consequences when something goes wrong. Because let's be very obvious. Let's state the obvious. Mistakes, errors, however you want to call it, this will happen. No matter how hard you try, and as a born and bred Northern German who now lives in different countries, I can tell you, no matter where you are in every culture, errors, mistakes happen, even in Germany, because some Brits will otherwise make the joke. And Germans don't have humor, as we all know. So errors, mistakes happen. And the problem is you often find leaders who say indulgence or practicing indulgence, being lenient to someone, is inappropriate. You should be very straightforward, have a talk with them, show consequences, countermeasures, move on. And that is not the best way how you approach this factor of either practicing indulgence or not. There are many outdated views on the market, and we are going to look into how to do it better. And we distinguish between three main factors when you want to talk about how to do it better. So first, it's about the subject matter expertise. Let's say someone from a content point of view, they do something wrong, they tried their best, but from a factual point of view, they did it wrong. And of course, what you're now looking for is feedback. And correct, yes, there is feedback. However, always distinguish between forgivable and non-forgivable errors. Non-forgivable errors, for example, are when, for example, life is put into danger, or when you violate ethics and morals, or when you do anything that is dangerous to the organization, for the organization's reputation, or anything like it. So when you think that it is more severe or not that severe, when it's not that severe, you give a feedback talk, and with a feedback talk, things will change afterwards. However, when it is severe and you say it is not really forgivable what happened here, feedback talks might be the first place. However, having a talk of critique, a critique discussion, is more important in that moment. By the way, something that is always an option, let's say a minor error happens and you think we cannot just move on, we need to mention it, but it's not that bad that we need to sit down with a formal talk, then you do pit stop feedback. Pit stop feedback is short, only informal, it is not documented anywhere. You basically meet someone in the hall room or in the break room somewhere. Very important is no one else is allowed to listen. So you need to be in a space where there's some privacy, because otherwise errors of people suddenly can become public against their will, which is never acceptable. So pit stop feedback means you just stand somewhere, sit somewhere, 5 to 15 minutes, talk about it, moving on. So basically you have three levels of escalation right now. First is the pit stop feedback. Second is the feedback talk. Third is the critique, which is the most severe one. Also, you need to be very sure that people know what critique means. Critique is the yellow card on the football pitch. Critique means there's something very bad that we need to talk about. And critique also means that when this keeps on going, we will not work together in the future. So it is something which you should save for an important moment, because when you use it too early, there are no more cards on the table you can draw from, or there are no more options on the table that you can choose from. When you do, at a very early stage, you do critique, it means that from there, prizes are made. And that means you now have to decide later if the person can stay in the organization or not. Also, be very self-reflective here. Was there a documented and structured onboarding process? Because people have a right to a documented and structured onboarding process. And by the way, when you now think of what you probably have heard in the past, oh yeah, my door is always open. Just walk around, find your stuff. You're going to figure it out. That is not onboarding. You need it structured and documented, and not or. If you only have it structured but not documented, it's probably very good, but as soon as the person doing it leaves, no one knows how to do it. It's nothing else than Druid knowledge. When you have it documented but not structured, you have something written down, but it's chaotic, and it's probably just arbitrary stuff thrown together on a piece of paper. So you must have it in a structured and documented manner. Only then you have the right to criticize people when they do something wrong from a subject matter expertise point of view. Second aspect, after we talked about the content point of view, second aspect is the personal one. The typical misconduct is people are not reliable, not punctual, or they say something which is obviously a lie. So people try to get away with it. This attitude of trying to get away with it because it worked in the past. Very important here. Always consider the person's social background. When you have to deal with someone who comes from an elitist academic background, probably third generation academic in the family, it is completely different compared to a person who probably grew up working class in very tough circumstances, worked their way up, and they simply learned in due course of their life that sometimes putting a lie here and there, you can just move on because it somehow worked in the past, so why shouldn't it work in the future? So always look at the social background, and there's a general rule of thumb. The more privileged someone is, the less tolerance we have to any kind of misconduct. Privileges mean there's an obligation because you received quite an amount of money. And by the way, you probably have heard of that issue that now in Europe, we have these dualistic universities where you work and study at the same time and trimesters, not semesters. And quite frequently, these people leave their so-called elitist institution with a quite high amount of arrogance, with very little experience in the working world. They suddenly show up in an organization and tell people who are there for 25 years how to do it properly, in their opinion. And of course, they smack on the ground very hard. So reality is going to give them a very straightforward wake-up call. And be sure that when people are on a very privileged level, you have to be more straightforward because people are very convinced of what they do. And they know that being confident often gave them a chance to get away with stuff, which is not what we want them to do. However, if you don't want to correct their behavior, you have a talk, then there's a solution that you work on, and then you have a change of behavior. If you don't see the change of behavior, repeat. You have a talk, you have a chat with them, you work on a solution, you see a change of behavior. That's the second aspect. The third aspect is the so-called social aspect. So when people misbehave or show misconduct towards other people in the organization. And of course, again, you have to see probably they only did it wrong because they don't know any better. When you, for example, for the first time in your life, present in front of a board, you probably do not know which words to use. You probably do not know how to present properly. You probably do not know which words to use, what they are looking for. What is it they are aiming at? You probably missed the mark by a mile if you haven't been coached properly. And if you don't know, you learn. However, that is not an excuse when people, for example, claim, oh, I didn't know that. And then we talk about, for example, making inappropriate sexist comments or unacceptable statements, homophobic statements, transphobic statements, insults, whatever. No matter where you come from, you know that these statements are unacceptable on any level, no matter where you come from. Very important, however, is what is the organizational culture? Maybe they heard that someone else and they thought, oh, it's obviously appropriate here to talk like that. Maybe you had leaders who showed misconduct and they just copied their behavior. Maybe you had leaders who simply didn't stick to the organizational culture, your mission, your vision, your value, and told younger people, this is how to do it. This is how to make a career here. This is how you make it in this organization. And people just copy their behavior. So always have self-reflection. What is your organizational culture? Maybe someone gave a bad example. Maybe you have leaders amongst your team who are not the best examples for other people in your organization. However, when you then sit down for a chat, always ask the other person of what have they seen, what do they think of the whole situation. So you go actively into reflection, and then often people suggest how to do it better in the future. And by the way, if they don't, you now have either a change of behavior or you have to sanction them. That is your choice then, because in general, you have a so-called three-strike principle. You do not do a feedback talk immediately when the first error happens. Normally, a couple of errors happen, a couple of misconducts happen before you say, hey, I think we need to properly sit down. As soon as you properly sit down, there's the three-strike principle. If you don't get it how to do it right after three strikes, then you're out. And that is very important. Save these strikes for important situations. Don't use them too early. In general, you can say you have to look into social and educational biographies. That is something that one of the largest scholarship organizations in Germany started to do, because back in the days when it came to scholarships, people normally stick to marks. They looked at what are your school marks, and you get a scholarship when you have great marks. Then science has proven that the first thing that you can derive from great school marks is their social upbringing. When you're privileged, your marks normally are better compared to people who either only have one parent or a parent they have to take care of. Maybe live in social hardship. They need to have a side job besides school to be able to afford anything. Surprisingly, people who don't have to do any of that and just go to school, everything else is paid, have better marks. What a surprise. So look at social and educational biographies. Where did they start? Where are they now? And that is, by the way, what scholarship companies more and more now do. In Germany, they do it for quite a number of years now, and they do very well with that. The general rule is the more privileged someone is, the less tolerance there is towards misconduct, because some people use their privilege to get protection from their network and show their misconduct openly and face no consequences. We have to see that when people are privileged, they got quite an amount of privilege only by birthright. There is no work behind that. And that means they have to live up to the standard that was given to them just by being born to the right family, the right place, the right city, the right organization, the right entrepreneurial family, whatever else. Unfortunately, in common practice, you do not see this. Common practice often means privileged person shows misconduct, very little to no consequences. And then you suddenly say, oh, how could we end up in press? Like KPMG did with Bill Michael, who massively showed misconduct more than once and only was called out after something went to public, went viral, and then KPMG had to act on that. So be sure that when you have these situations where privileged people show misconduct and you have no consequences, you establish the framework for other people to do exactly the same. And then you cannot treat them any different. The main question you have to answer here is, on which side of justice for humans and your organization are you? Your call. And of course, I published about this. First, thank you very much for listening to this podcast for a long time now. We again made it into the top 100 on social media, LinkedIn, Instagram. You can see the rankings we achieved there. However, if some people of new you now might say, hey, I still have a couple of questions. Can I just chat with you or can I exchange with you some thoughts via email? Absolutely. Just drop me an email, nb@nb-networks.com, and then we take it from there. If you have something very specific, training, speaking, coaching, you need whatever, someone at your event, happy to do that. You can text that to me as well. However, you can just text me your question and then we take it from there. nb@nb-networks.com. And if you want more and you want to get free access to everything I publish every week, expert.nb-networks.com. Just sign up there for the leadership letter. It's only one email every Wednesday morning, 100% content, ad-free guarantee, available in English and German language. So feel free to sign up there, because only there you get free access to anything I publish. There are quite a number of places where you can find publications from me. However, many of these publications are publications that are behind a paywall. Free access only via the leadership letter. Thank you very much for signing up. And the last option, sorry, not the last option, the last step I always recommend is apply. Did I mention apply? Yeah. Apply. What you learned in this podcast, because only when you apply what you see here, you will see the positive change that you want to have in your organization. I wish you all the best trying to do that. I wish you all the best implementing these steps. There might be some people who will not be too happy, especially about dealing with privileged people, because some privileged people don't like to be called privileged. So there might be some steps that you have to take and some talks you have to do before people accept what the facts and science actually are. I wish you all the best implementing these in your organization. I am always there to help. Let me know if you need help and I'm happy to do so. And at the end of this podcast, there's only one thing left for me to say. Thank you very much for your time.